This is Duke University.
So this evening, it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker, Dr. Brian Goldman, a renowned thinker and leader on issues of medical error and medical culture. In addition to being a practicing emergency physician at Mount Sinai Hospital in Toronto, Dr. Goldman also hosts an award-winning radio show on CBC Radio 1 called White Coat Black Art. His book, The Night Shift, Real Life in the Heart of the ER, offers an incredible glimpse at life in the hospital emergency room at the witching hours of the night. He's currently working on a book addressing the relationship between medical slang and medical culture. His celebrated TED Talk, Doctors Make Mistakes, Can We Talk About That?, was viewed by over 700,000 people on TED.com. So, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Brian Goldman.
Thank you, Ani, for that very, very kind introduction, and also thank you to you and Jocelyn and Olivia and Noni for as student directors for welcoming me and for fashioning, crafting what I think will be a very exciting and stimulating week. The preparations have been fantastic, and you know, if you have an opportunity to partake in the rest of the events this week, it will be a pleasure and a tribute to their hard work. I'd also like to acknowledge Dr. Andrew Huang for providing the support for me to come here today. It is a great pleasure, and it is a wonderful opportunity to meet a kindred spirit, and I look forward to having more conversations about this very serious subject. I'm going to be talking about something else right now, and that is the F word. Not the bad one, but the other one, and that is, of course, failure. So I want us to, we're going to be meditating on failure for the next hour or so, and then we'll have plenty of time for questions. And I'm going to present to you, I'm going to begin by presenting to you two views that I would argue are prevalent in our society, and they're very different from one another. And I want to ask you a question rhetorically. Which one do you subscribe to as your worldview of failure? Is it this one? And you've seen the slogans, you know, it's a very famous slogan: if at first you don't succeed, try again. You know, persistence, the football player who has fallen down and gets up, picks themselves up off the mat, you know all the cliches. Fall down 7 times, get up 8 times. I think a lot of us find that a very seductive and a very tantalizing worldview of failure. Or is this your worldview? This is a different kind of message. And, you know, I invite you to think for a moment of what that sign means. You have success going in one direction, you have failure going in the other direction, and it looks like it's binary. It looks like you're either heading in the right direction or you're heading in the wrong direction. And I want to invite you, before the end of this, of my remarks tonight, to redraw that map in a way that might be more satisfying and actually might track better with reality. In fact, if you learn nothing else tonight from what I'm about to say, I'm going to tell you that every important thing that I have ever learned since I was born, every important thing that I have ever learned since the day I was born, has come from a mistake, at least one. And if you learn nothing else today, this evening, I hesitate about saying tonight because it's still brilliantly sunny, at least think about the possibility that that one might be true and what the implications would be if it were true in healthcare, and we'll get into that. And I've made many doozies in my life, including a mistake that I made while I was in college, while I was in medical school at the University of Toronto. I did a 2-month elective not far from here at Johns Hopkins. And it was part of my master plan to become a neurologist. And I was going to, as part of that plan, I was going to come down to Johns Hopkins Hospital and do my 2-month elective and wow my mentors and score those great recommendations that would get me that residency position so that I would return back to Canada in triumph. And at the time, I was already a veteran insomniac. I had a tendency to wake up early, and I would toss and turn, and every morning I would feel this sense that I wasn't getting enough sleep, and And that seemed to be the way my life would work, all except one morning. And that was the morning that I was supposed to, you know, at the pinnacle of my elective in my fourth year of medical school, doing this elective, I was supposed to deliver grand rounds in the Department of Neurology and really impress my mentors. And that morning, I woke up at about 3:30 or 3:45, went to the bathroom, went back to bed, rolled over, and the next time I was awakened, it was 10 a.m., which just coincidentally happened to be the moment when I was supposed to be presenting rounds. Tore off my pajamas, put on my clothes, ran across the street up the many flights of stairs to the neurology conference room. Not as beautiful a room as this, but a room much like this. And you know, those of you who ever saw The Graduate know that moment. I was standing outside kind of screaming, "Elaine, Elaine." And my senior resident, who I guess he must have seen something in me that reminded him of himself, you know, that little self-loathing that happens in medicine if you know the culture of medicine, he kind of smiled when he saw the look of distress on my face and said, "It's okay, Brian, you're too late." And everybody laughed. And I have to tell you that at that moment, it was the worst moment of my life. It was the most humiliating moment of my life. You know, about 5 years and a lot of therapy later, it was in fact the best moment of my life, because finally a still small voice screamed out at me and said, "Goldman, not for you, not your path." And I listened. I paid attention. It was a dramatic enough gesture. And you know, sometimes, you know, I don't wish a medical error on anybody. I don't wish the misfortune that happens to the people, the patients and their families who were directly involved. But sometimes it's a moment like that that redirects you and gets you to thinking about what you need to do with the rest of your life. So that was one of my first mistakes. And I'd made others up until that point in time. A funny thing has happened in the last few years. This is, there's a conference, and I don't know if you've ever heard of it. You can Google it. It's called FailCon. Failures become sexy. And this is just one example. This guy, Mike Arsenault, was involved in a company called Grasshopper, and he came up with a great idea. It was called Spreadable. The idea was to harness the power of word of mouth to generate automated referrals for business. It's a great tool. Basically, the product bombed, lost all his money. But instead of kind of slinking away in shame, what Arsenault did was he went out on the lecture circuit and started talking to us about what went wrong, why it went wrong, and guess what? He became the darling of the lecture circuit and certainly the darling of FailCon, and there will be another FailCon this year. Pastors do it. There is a conference called Epic Fail. Somehow I wish they'd called it Biblical Fail. But this is a conference in which pastors aren't allowed to talk about anything other than their worst mistakes. And it starts with moans and groans, and then it ends with what can we learn from this. And that's really important. The catharsis is one thing, but you have to be able to grow from the mistake. And that means finding one thing that you can pass on that helps you understand why it happened. Well, one is business and the other is the priesthood. And you know what they say. You've heard the saying. We've all heard the saying, haven't we? You know, it's not brain surgery. Nobody died, right? And you know, that's the reassuring thing that we tell people anywhere but medicine. Tell that to us, anybody who works in healthcare, anybody here who's interested in working in healthcare. In 1999, I'm sure you've heard of the Institute of Medicine's famous report, To Err Is Human, pegged the number of deaths per year at 98,000 at American hospitals due to preventable medical errors. Today, if you include all errors, you know, whether you know that they're preventable or you're not sure, it adds up to about 200,000 per year. It's a lot. And the scale of it in the airline industry, well, we'll talk about that near the end. And I think even more telling than that, if you talk to if you do surveys of hospital administrators, nurses, people in the know, the vast majority of them will tell you that they expect medical errors, serious errors, to occur while patients are in hospital. So it's not very reassuring. And, you know, I can give you some examples. There are many examples. Hospital-acquired infections, that's a very interesting one. These are superbugs like MRSA, C. difficile, Klebsiella, KPC, which is the latest and probably one of the most devastating of the superbugs. And it's interesting and telling just how much we who practice medicine for a long, long time regarded hospital-acquired infections as the cost of doing business. It's just something that happened. And in fact, it's one of the leading causes, one of the top three or four leading causes of preventable deaths in hospital. Preventable. And we know the reasons why they occur. Top of the list, poor hand washing compliance, and I don't know about which hospital you go to or which hospital you work in, but in places in Canada, hand washing rates among health professionals who ought to know better can fall to as low as 25% or 30%. And there are some hospitals that are innovators, but they're the outliers and the ones that are pushing 95%. And the norm is low rates, surprisingly low rates of hand washing. And, you know, there are other factors, failure to follow checklists, antiseptic checklists for prior to doing invasive procedures like central lines and changing catheters, removing urinary catheters when they're no longer needed. Poorly designed sinks, that's another one as well. That's beyond the ken or the responsibility of individual physicians. There was a case series that was reported in the New England Journal of Medicine, if I'm not mistaken. It was from Toronto General Hospital, University Health Network, in which an outbreak of a serious and lethal superbug occurred. It was a form of Pseudomonas. And many people were infected and a large percentage of them died, and it took them a long time to uncover what was going on in this brand new intensive care unit. And it turned out that the fault was one sink, the sink that was used by people entering and exiting the intensive care unit. And what was wrong with the design of the sink was that it had a high bowl and a long neck faucet, and when water hit the bottom of the sink, it tended to splatter to the sides. But the first thing that it would do is it would head straight down into, you know, we in medicine tend to invent this jargon that sounds technical. It's called the biofilm, but that's a fancy way of saying the scum at the bottom of the sink. So it hit the scum at the bottom of the sink, gathered up the bacteria, and brought them up and flung them all over people's hands. And they literally stopped the deaths, the infections and the deaths, the day somebody figured it out and literally put a makeshift paper sign, taped it over the sink and said, do not use this sink. And then the death stopped. Amazing. Another example, radiology. Discrepancies in CT scan interpretations. They seem to be very common, but X-ray interpretations, MRIs as well. And it often takes too long. The problem with erroneous CT interpretations is that it can take months and even years until it's uncovered. And that's part of the problem, discovering that, unless you're regularly monitoring somebody for their accuracy. Medication errors. 1 in 10 medications are the wrong medication, the wrong dosage, the wrong route of administration. That's the rough and ready figure. Some statistics that I can tell you about: 19% of doses administered at 36 institutions were in error, 7% potentially harmful. That was considered an underestimate. And the Institute of Medicine pegged the annual cost in the United States of preventable medication errors only, which is just one piece of the entire array of errors, at $2 billion per year. Some other examples: intensive care unit, MedMarks, which is an anonymous, self-reported, confidential, de-identified system, identified or uncovered a disproportionate number of harmful errors in the intensive care unit, with an odds ratio of nearly 3 to 1, to causing permanent harm or necessitating life-saving treatment, 2.48 to death. The causes, two of the most important causes, dispensing devices and calculation mistakes. And the telling thing here, which I'm sure we will talk about either the questions tonight or tomorrow night, is that patients and caregivers were rarely informed, let alone apologized to. This is a very recent study that was published last month by White, who's a human factors engineer. And human factors engineers are the people that we really need to be talking to, because they're the ones that are looking at the cognitive mistakes that people like me make, and nurses, other allied health professionals. As healthcare becomes more and more complex, we really need the helping hand of human factors engineers who are showing us where we make the mistakes and helping to design equipment that isn't so darn hard to operate. Well, White and her group from Toronto General Hospital did field observations at 6 Canadian cancer centers, and they found 3 types of heretofore unrecognized errors. Reconstitution errors, that means you take a powder, a lyophilized powder, mix it with a solution, with a diluent, and then reconstitute it, either using the wrong volume of fluid, the wrong diluent, or the wrong medication selected, or the wrong patient drug label. And I can tell you that we are dealing right now in Ontario and New Brunswick with a scandal in which a compounding pharmacy, private pharmacy, without a lot of oversight or accountability, was preparing and mixing chemo, which was then delivered to hospitals and was supposed to be diluted according to a set schedule, a set method. And unfortunately, in a large percentage of the dosages given, we're talking about hundreds if not thousands, the patients were underdosed by a factor of about 10% to 15%. And they're just starting to unpack the potential damage. There may have been no damage, or there may have been a lot of damage. The point here, what's scary about this, is that these are errors that are potentially catastrophic and yet completely undetectable. You can't look at that bag and know that it's the wrong drug or that it's about to be given to the wrong patient. You know, unless they're really very, very hard to detect. So far, I've been talking about systems. Let's not forget that there's a patient. And one of the things I'm going to do tonight in the time that I have is I'm going to play for you some excerpts from my show, White Coat, Black Art, because I've made a study of medical errors on the show. And I want you to meet a woman who suffered a medical error. Her name is Nancy Mojica Fisher. She went to an outpatient hospital clinic for a drug called Remicade, which is a biological. It's used in Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. It's also used in psoriasis and other autoimmune diseases. And she went to the clinic, and there was only she and another patient in the outpatient clinic, and somehow they mixed up the two drugs, and she ended up receiving chemotherapy by mistake. I want you to listen to how she found out and the aftermath.
3 o'clock, I got a call on my cell phone and told me that they gave me the chemo treatment as opposed to Remicade. And of course, my first reaction was denial. You must have the wrong number. But is this Nancy Mojica Fisher? I said yes. And of course, it sunk in, and I felt so shaky at that point in time. I mean, when I realized that I was really given the chemo. So anyway, they summoned me to come back to the ambulatory clinic, and I got there. Sat on the chair. There were these two nurses. The nurse who administered me, who hooked me up intravenously, she wasn't there, the one who made a mistake. Of course, the head or the one who was supervising her and the supervisor, head nurse. And of course, I asked them, what have happened? I was so angry and I was crying. What happened? How did it happen? And they just told me, it's human error and we are very sorry. And I was just mad. I couldn't say any more, but because it's like I'm just furious inside. So I said to them, I want to see a doctor. I want to see my physician, my family doctor. And they were telling me, well, we're trying to get hold of her, but she's off.
You mean they didn't provide a doctor for you at
no,
that point?
No, they didn't. In fact, I was the one who asked them. I said, I'm not going to leave this hospital unless I seen a doctor, because I don't know if I'm still alive tomorrow, I mean, an hour from now. And, of course, they called one of the physicians in the, of course, in the building, and he came and told me that, oh, it's only one bag. I felt like I was patronized, honestly. It was only one bag. I gave it to my patients anyway. Well, drink a lot of water. And of course, I asked about my tongue is so sharp, my mouth, like as if I've eaten a lot of tin can, and then my stomach is like burning. I got this burning sensation in my stomach. And like, that's what he told me. Drink a lot of water. And of course, I'm queasy and stuff like that. I don't know, it's the anxiety. And he asked one of the nurses to give me gravel, and that's it.
And really, you know, we're in the early days of apologizing. That was actually an attempt to apologize and to try to set the wheels in motion to mitigating. It was clearly not the best way to do it. And maybe in the question period, we'll talk about the impact of apologies. But what would constitute a correct way of doing an apology? But you know, I've given you lots of phenomena. I think we have to start drilling down a little bit deeper. And I guess the first question is why? Why does this happen? We are among the most caring people who work in healthcare. They, you know, I can, you know, other than the sociopaths, and you know, they're in every walk of life. And I'm sure there's some sociopaths in medicine and allied health professions. But you know, the vast majority of people would do anything to undo it. And it's certainly not because we don't care. And you know, anybody who's practiced as long as I have, I've practiced 30 years, I can tell you that you always remember the names of the ones who had the complications. You can do, you know, I've probably seen, you know, tens of thousands, might have seen 60, 70,000, 80,000 patients over the last 30 years, because, you know, that's the way it works in the emergency department. You see lots and lots of different patients. And I don't remember their names like I remember the names of the ones who had the complications. And that's true for emergency physicians. It's also true for surgeons, obstetricians, gynecologists, internists, and what have you. And it's not just physicians. It's nurses. Let's not forget. I want you to hear a couple of nurses talking about a couple of the worst mistakes that they've made. This is Jan Thompson and Angela Mercier, who are triage nurses. And, you know, triage is a really difficult job. It's a job in which you have to size up patients quickly and categorize them. Bring them in right away, take a seat, wait a while, and you do that while people, and then if you ask people to take a seat, you've got their family members coming up saying, when is she coming in, when's he coming in, and maybe then somebody comes in who is violent, starts to take their clothes off in the waiting room, and they have to be dealt with on an emergent basis, and then other patients come in, and all the while, the people you've asked to take a seat might be getting sicker and sicker. So my heart goes out to triage nurses, and I want you to hear two of them just talking about some of their worst mistakes.
You know, it happens, right? There's things where you come back and you think, I should have got that, I should have seen that, I should have known. And I think those things occur when you're tired, when you've worked too much, when the patient acuity is so high that you just almost feel overwhelmed with your day. And there's things you miss, for sure.
I missed a subarachnoid, a brain bleed, and I was really devastated. I actually went home and dissolved into a puddle of tears. I was really, really upset. Now, thank God the outcome was fine, but it was this woman who had come in, and she presents saying, I have a chronic history of migraine headaches, and I think I'm having one, but it's just a little bit different this time, and, you know, there's more nausea this time. And, you know, I can certainly explain that, yes, it was very busy, and yes, I was tired, but it doesn't excuse the fact that I didn't ask one more question. I didn't take a closer look.
I want you to hear another little story as well. This is from Laura Adams, quite a remarkable woman. Still a registered nurse, but not practicing as one. She's president and CEO of Rhode Island Quality Institute, which is dedicated to making healthcare safer in Rhode Island by bringing in electronic health records and medication reconciliation. She's also a former hospital executive at Parkview Episcopal Medical Center. And these mistakes that happen at a tender age stick with you, and I want you to hear one that she was involved with as a frontline nurse.
I started off as a nurse, and anytime you're a clinician, you live in fear that you're going to get the call someday that you've made a medical error. And that came for me very early in my life. I was a young 22-year-old nurse, and I was leaving a night shift, a very stressful night shift, and I got ready to leave, and I heard the intercom come on, and I heard our surgeon downstairs. We only had two doctors on staff at that small hospital, and the surgeon said, "Is Laura still here?" And I'd worked with Dr. Lee a long time, so I knew that that sound in his voice was ominous, and I hurried over to the intercom, and I said, "Dr. Lee, I'm still here," and he said, "Laura, I don't know what you gave this 7-year-old child." He said, "But Laura, we're losing her. She's dying down here. I need to know what pre-op medication that you gave her." It was like someone had thrown a bucket of ice water over me. The feeling, and I felt like I was going to throw up, that I couldn't breathe. And I raced over to the medication area, and I looked down, and I instantly knew that I had given her a massive overdose of the drug scopolamine. And this child was having seizures, slipping into a coma downstairs. So I stood there just praying that something would happen to, by some miracle, save that child's life. Something did. Something saved that child's life. She survived my care that night, but just barely.
And you can hear, as she recalls it, the anguish in her voice, and I can certainly relate to praying. That's exactly what I did when I talk about a woman who I call Mrs. Drucker, that wasn't actually her name, in my TED talk, and I remember praying that she would recover from what happened to her. Unfortunately, in her situation, she didn't. But it's something that you do. It may not be a wise thing to do, and it may not be a way of mitigating, but it is something that we do. So I want to start talking about some of the factors that contribute to mistakes. And we can start talking about the list, and everybody's got their list of factors, you know, disorganized workflow, fatigue, staff, sleep deprivation, of course, frequent interruptions and distractions, handwriting. And I know we're starting to see more and more electronic health records, but until they come on stream, we still depend an awful lot on handwriting. Emphasis on volume over quality, that's emphasis on productivity. There are productivity demands on us at all times. And those productivity demands are making it more and more difficult for us to deliver care that's safe. Stress, certainly, I've experienced that. Ineffective communication with patients and each other, inadequate staffing, and I look at that list and it sounds a lot like where I work. We can reduce a lot of those stressors, but I can tell you that unless there's a commitment to actually do it, it may not be happening. You may be finding that you're just trying to do the same job while at the same time dealing with productivity pressures. And if you are, then I guarantee you, you're going to be cutting corners. And when you cut corners, mistakes will happen. Here's one example. Take a look at that. And this is the bane of the pharmacist's existence, you know. I haven't mentioned pharmacists. They are party to mistakes. They may be secondary to a mistake. They may be party to a mistake that comes from an inaccurate physician order or incorrect physician order. Or it may be a problem like this, where they're looking at a medication list and trying to reconcile it with two other lists. And the question is, whose job is it to reconcile medications? Especially when you've got patients who are transitioning from one part of the healthcare system to another. It's a big problem. A second factor, complexity. I've alluded to it, but I'll say more about it right now. Medicine, medical knowledge and pharmacy knowledge, just two areas, are doubling every few years. And just to look at the example of the number of prescription drugs that are out there, in 1976, there were between 300 and 400 medications in the pharmacopoeia, in the list of medications. You could be an expert and know them all. Well, in 1996, and that was just 16 or 17 years ago, there were 4,000 medications, and there's even more today. And it is simply not possible to know everything about every medication. And so I never know, unless I look it up, unless I take the time to look it up, will the medication that I'm about to prescribe in the emergency department cause a catastrophic drug interaction? And you say to yourself, look it up. What's the problem? Of course you look it up. We all do. But I spoke to one pharmacy director who told me that if you simply add 30 seconds of lookup to each and every prescription that's dispensed at the hospital pharmacy where he works, he'd have to hire two full-time equivalents to be able to do it. Now, you have to have money to be able to do that. And if you don't have the money to do that, you've got a problem. So you can see this is part of the kind of institutional or systemic cutting of corners that all of us have to go through just to deliver half-decent care. We've got older and sicker patients. And you know, I would say that I wasn't worried about the bomb, you know, what we call the slang word, the bomb, you know, the patient having an untoward or an unexpected reaction, or that there's some little bit of knowledge that I wish I knew. And it's not that those things happen all the time, but that there's this low-level anxiety. It's you know, David Kuhl, who is a psychologist at Fraser Health Ethics in British Columbia, said this to me last week. He gives a talk with a very provocative title, "Who Do You Sleep With?" And it's not about sex. It's about the patients who wake you up in the middle of the night. And these are the patients who make me wake up in the middle of the night. I mentioned fragmented healthcare. You have how many transition points? You have a medical home, you have a family doctor, you have a clinic, you have a long-term care facility, you have a hospital, you have another facility where an outpatient procedure is being done. And each one of these is a transition point and an opportunity for an important bit of information about the patient's well-being not to be transmitted. It's a great argument for a universally accessible electronic health record, you know, if it were available all the time. And there are lots of other factors here as well, other pressures. Do you have a drug shortage problem in the United States? Sure you do. Your drug shortage problem is worse than ours because you have paramedics who are actually packing expired drugs on their medicine carts and their ambulances because they have that critical a shortage of medications. In Canada, we know that there are hundreds of drugs on back order. So what are the implications of that? It means two things. First of all, it means that we might be resorting to older drugs that are not as safe. So for instance, a shortage of the diuretic furosemide, or Lasix, will necessitate the use of ethocrinic acid, which is an effective drug, but it has a wee problem. It can precipitate renal failure more easily than furosemide or Lasix can. The other thing that we're noticing with shortages of drugs is that with younger and younger health professionals, they're not used to using the older drugs. So they have to either go back to school or they risk making mistakes because they don't know the properties of the drugs that they're using. So case in point, Alina Rossnagel was supposed to have a kidney stone removed, and she was getting recurrent urinary tract infections, and she was intolerant of several antibiotics but one, trimethoprim. And that was the only oral preparation that she could take. So one day, she went to her pharmacy to get the prescription, was told it's on back order. But she needed it because she was at imminent risk of urosepsis, having an infection in her kidneys from a stone that becomes infected. She went to her family doctor. Her family doctor prescribed the only medication that she could tolerate, and that was an aminoglycoside called gentamicin. And it was to be administered in the emergency department of the local hospital on an outpatient basis. And round about 4 weeks later, she started to find that whenever she moved in a moving car or walking along, she got so dizzy that she fell to the ground, and she suffered a grievous side effect called oscillopsia. Now, you know, the drug shortage didn't cause that, although it led to her having to be on gentamicin. But the real problem here was that the person who was prescribing it was not familiar with the substitute drug. And these are the pressures that we have to deal with. And you know, there is a temptation, you know, if you work in the emergency department or in a critical care area, another high intensity area of the hospital, that to suffer from this. And that is the answer to every problem is a new rule. And rules are good as long as they take into account the realities of the situation. But many of us suffer from rule fatigue. And that rule fatigue just makes it difficult for us. We have so many contradictory rules that we find it more and more difficult to follow them. And the risk is that patients will suffer as a result. So those are factors in the system. Clearly, I'm here to talk about factors that are personal, that are a little bit more personal. And it goes back. Ani, in his fine introduction, mentioned that I'm the host of a radio show called White Coat Black Art, and I've made a study of the culture of modern medicine. I think of myself as a bit of a medical sociologist, but I have the advantage of actually working in healthcare, so I can be led into the bunker, as they call it, the surgical bunker or the internal medicine bunker in the hospital, and they'll talk to me as they did today. I found that very fascinating. So I can talk about that. And one of the things I want to talk about is the culture that addresses medical errors. And I have to go back to my medical school. You know, what did my professors teach me about making mistakes? And honestly, not much. You know, and in fact, I would say that they were pretty silent about medical mistakes. Oh, they talked about them. Don't do this. Don't do that. If they talked about a case, they might talk about, often in disparaging terms, family doctor or patient was seen at Elsewhere General, we call it. You may remember the TV show St. Elsewhere, where bad things happened to patients. And then the patient was at St. Elsewhere, and they screwed up. And then finally the patient was brought to our hospital where we saved them. I don't know how many of my mentors actually told me about a mistake they made. I think very, very few of them. Most of the time, it was silence. And the thing about human beings is that when you are greeted with silence, you fill in the blanks. And you begin to put two and two together. That's what we call the hidden curriculum. And I like to talk about this. You know, for those of you who are getting bored with the medicine right now, here's a bit of baseball. That may bore you even more. That is Miguel Cabrera, who is the first hitter, Triple Crown winner since Carl Yastrzemski in the 1960s. So he led the major leagues in homers, home runs, runs batted in, and batting average. And I just want to focus on the one thing. Those of you who didn't hear my TED Talk, I mean, you know where I'm going with this. If you heard the TED Talk, you know. Batting average. So he batted .330. And for those of you who don't know what a batting average is, that's the number of times out of 100, I guess, that you bat safely, which means that when you hit the ball is not caught. It lands either in the infield, usually in the outfield. It bounces, and the runner is able to get to first base before a ball can be thrown. The ball can be thrown to first base. So that's 33 times out of 100, 330 times out of 1,000. Got my math wrong for a second. And that's considered a terrific batting average. And in my TED Talk, I talked about Ted Williams, who was the last major league ball player to hit over 400, which is batting safely 40 times every 100, 40%. But if I ask you the question, if you were about to if you had appendicitis and you were about to undergo an appendectomy, how would you feel if your surgeon told you that they were batting 400 on appendectomies? I kind of think that it wouldn't be good enough for you. And if I were to ask rhetorically what you think, what should be the batting average of a physician or a nurse, phlebotomist, a radiation oncologist, an oncologist, a surgeon, a OBGYN, what have you, and if I've missed anybody, forgive me, what should their batting average be? Well, there's that silence again. 1,000. I think that's what you infer. Don't make a mistake, and so if you do make a mistake, well, there's a whole bunch of ramifications that happen. But I would put to you that in medicine, our view of mistakes, or at least I'm filling in through the silence. We may not feel this way, but this seems to be the message that it's not hard to gather, and that is that if you make a mistake, you have two options. Neither of them are pretty. One of them is that you're lazy or that you slipped. Characterological flaw. The second one is that you're incompetent. So which one would you prefer? I messed up, I goofed, I was lazy, or something like that, and hope that the moment passes and hope that the next one doesn't happen too closely. We'll get to that in just a moment. I want to talk about shame. the personal shame that we feel when we make mistakes in the culture of medicine. And the guy I want to help me do that is Graham Cunningham, who is the medical director of the Alcohol, Drug, and Treatment Program in a place called Homewood Health Center. Dr. Cunningham, specializes in treating health professionals with substance abuse issues. Now, prior to that, he was a respected cardiologist, and that was his public image. In private, he abused alcohol to deal with the fear of failure, and I want you to hear the way he talks about competence and insecurity.
I think the alcohol was a way of letting me relax and get off the pedestal. Basically, my own personality is I'm an egomaniac with an inferiority complex. And so what you see in the outside is not what's happening in the inside. And I always felt, as a doctor, I was a bit of a fraud. I really wasn't doing a good enough job, and I was just lucky to be there. Other doctors all deserved to be there, but somehow I wasn't good enough. And I think the alcohol tended to mellow that out.
But I think every, you know what, I feel that way. I feel as if every time a consultant puts me in my place, they're only revealing what is obvious, that I'm a flawed and inferior doctor and that they're superior. So many doctors feel that way.
And that's an interesting comment. I would agree with that now, having treated many doctors over the last 20 years. But when I was ill, when I was in this place of not being good enough, of course, one of the things you don't do is you don't talk. The cliche I use is, in the secrets lies the sickness. And we were a bunch of people in a hospital working together alone.
Now, most of them don't drink, but they do feel despair. And that deep-seated feeling of insecurity, I would maintain, is part of that perfectionistic tendency of physicians. They just don't like to be caught out making a mistake. It's one of the reasons why they find it difficult to say, I don't know. And that's a problem as you get older. Because as you get older, you know, there's the bathtub model of medical education where, you know, you're in med school, pre-med, med school, and the faucet's on full, and your medical knowledge is being built up like water in a bathtub, and then you go do residency, some more water goes in, and you do a year or two of fellowship, more water goes in, and you're a finished product. There's your bathtub of medical knowledge, or nursing knowledge, or any other healthcare provider, respiratory therapist. Then they send you out into practice, and that's the moment when they pull the plug on the bathtub. And so, you know, what starts off as lessons learned become forgotten, lessons learned become outmoded, medical knowledge doubles, et cetera, and then it becomes, and you hope, you know, the old hope was that people would have the good graces to retire before the last bit of water ran out of the bathtub. And I know there are people who are thinking, well, we have continuing education. You can get credits and you get lectures. And I have to say, this is a personal view, that I don't believe that continuing education in any way can replicate the undergraduate or postgraduate experience of total immersion. It's like, you know, taking one of those 5-day courses or pretending that you can maintain fluency in French or Mandarin or whatever by visiting Montreal or China for 5 days a year. You can't. And that's the myth that we have. And we all say we don't have time. Here's another problem. Sleep deprivation, and that's a very hot topic in the corridors of medicine. The reason why is that studies show that sleep deprivation, we have a lot of studies, by the way, of sleep deprivation and its impact on residents, but nobody else, which is interesting. 17 hours of continuous sleep deprivation, and that's an important figure, is equivalent to alcohol intoxication in terms of how it impacts on your judgment. That's continuous sleep deprivation, but there's something called partial sleep deprivation, and about 2 weeks of 5 hours of sleep a night can actually cause a decrease in your cognitive performance. And if you talk to internal medicine residents, surgeons, anesthesia residents, all of them who have been studied will say that that sleep deprivation was a factor in their worst errors in their job performance. And, you know, there was a change, a major change, about 20 years ago, 30 years ago. Libby Zion. This was the case that changed everything, apparently. Admitted to a New York hospital in 1984 with a high fever. She had myoclonic jerking movements and agitation, a history of depression. She was on an MAO inhibitor called phenylzine. She complained of pain. She was given repeated doses of Demerol, and she went through this cycle of each time she would moan, and she was feverish and delirious, and they would call the intern, and the intern would order a dose of Demerol, and she would get more feverish and more delirious, and the nurses would call saying she's in pain, more Demerol, and on and on and on, and she died the next morning. Her brain cooked. She died of hyperthermia. And there was a grand jury that was convened. It was the first report to cite residence hours as a major factor in the death of this young woman. And that by itself led to some major changes. The Accreditation Council for Graduate Medical Education changed the rules, and they've been changed. We call them duty hours. That's the slang term that we use it, to 80 hours per week. And 24 hours in a row, it's now down to 16 hours. But here's the thing. Today's residents admit that they don't exercise the right to go home earlier. And we don't really know right now. In fact, there's some evidence to suggest that shortening duty hours does not improve patient safety. It may actually increase the despair and the dissatisfaction of residents who are afraid that they're not learning the lessons they need to learn. Part of the problem here may be that while duty hours are being reduced, duties are not being reduced, which means you have to wedge your duties into a shorter period of time. Patient safety is probably not improved because with each reduction in duty hours, you actually have an increase in the number of handovers, which is one patient, which is one physician handing over, one resident handing over to another. Each time there's a handover, you increase the risk that you can have errors. And so patient and trainee welfare is still being compromised. And if you talk to residents, they will tell you that even though in certain specialties, particularly surgery, even though they have the right to go home, they often don't because they're afraid of getting a poor evaluation. Or it may be altruistic reasons. They may feel that the way the ward is set up, the team is set up, nobody knows their patient as well as they do. And so they're afraid that their patient will suffer because they're not hanging around. So it's a kind of a messy situation. Something that I want to talk about that's very, very important, and it's something that we don't talk about enough, and that is that many of the errors that I have made in my career, that fellow health professionals make, come from faulty thinking, cognitive errors, and I'm indebted to my colleague at Dalhousie University, who has written a book about medical errors, and most of what he wrote was borrowed with permission by Jerome Groopman in his wonderful book, How Doctors Think. And there is a whole list of cognitive errors that we make, and the errors that we make come from certain cognitive biases that we have. And you know, you've probably read the book Blink by Malcolm Gladwell. You've heard of it. You know that what we do is we tend to size things up really quickly, and most of the time it works, but sometimes it doesn't, particularly when we're under stress, when we're under time pressure, and we have certain cognitive biases that will lead us inexorably to make mistakes. And I want to give you know, rather than talking about it theoretically, I'd like you to hear two bits of tape. The first will be Bruce Campana, a friend and colleague of mine, who's an emergency physician now at Victoria General Hospital in British Columbia. He will talk about a horrible mistake, and this was not a near miss. This was one that ended in a death. And then I will play for you Jerome Groopman analyzing what Bruce Campana had to say. So first the mistake, and then the analysis of the cognitive errors.
Some poor guy come in that was autistic. He's about 30 years old, and he was brought in screaming and violent, and he would try and reach out and grab people. He was a large male, and people were afraid of him. And the care home came in and said, look, he always gets like this when he's constipated. Can we just give him an enema and get out of here? So we gave him an enema, and actually I got a big guy to try and disimpact him, and the guy was screaming and yelling, and the care people said, look, this always happens. Can we just take him home? So he went home, and then I came in for my next shift. And you know that feeling when you come into the shift and somebody looks up and they say those fateful words, do you remember that patient you saw last year? He's dead. And he, of course, had a ruptured appendix at the autopsy. And, you know, life doesn't make sense sometimes.
In fact, it made perfect sense to Jerome Groopman. So you've got the story. Watch or listen to Jerome Groopman analyze it.
First, let's start with what's called a framing error. So this man, this 30-year-old autistic man, is put in the frame of constipation. He's often constipated. We also have what's called an availability error, meaning that what first came to mind is the diagnosis that occurred in the past. He's been constipated in the past. This is the same pattern. So it's the same thing. That's what's most available in your mind. That also causes a cascade of what's called diagnosis momentum. It's like a boulder rolling down a hill, gathering force. This is what it is. This is what it's been in the past. There's also what's called an attribution error, and this is on the emotional side. We tend to find difficult patients, difficult to handle, perhaps people who we can't connect with emotionally, like autistic people or mentally ill people. We don't like them often when we're physicians. They make our lives much more difficult. There's no way to get a history from this man. So we're more apt to quickly attribute whatever is going on to the stereotype that we have, which is a flailing, constipated, autistic man, and we want to get him out of the emergency department as quickly as possible. All of those factors in thinking and feeling coalesced to cause this tragedy.
Let me tell you a little bit more about cognitive errors. This is the famous WHO, World Health Organization, surgical safety checklist that Atul Gawande has been the big spearhead behind, and it's a wonderful concept, and it's an important concept, and it will become automated. But I do want to make a point. It's a series of things that you should do in the correct order before you operate, before you do a procedure, and the whole idea behind it is to prevent so-called never events from occurring. Things like operating on the wrong part of the body or the wrong side of the body. And it's something that is being adopted the world over, and it's making a difference. But anybody who thinks that you can throw a checklist into the mix and that's going to be the fix-all doesn't understand how people think. Let me give you an example. In April 2011, a Portland ophthalmologist operated on the wrong eye of a 4-year-old kid. And in that mishap, the mark over the correct eye was covered before the operation. It was kind of a perfect storm. The ophthalmologist said she lost her sense of direction. Now, some people would say, well, you should leave the room. You should leave the profession if you lose your sense of direction. But people do that when they're under stress. A friend of mine, a psychiatrist, told the story of her father, who she brought to the emergency department, complaining of what he thought was indigestion, where he was seen by a friend and colleague of the psychiatrist who was the emergency physician on duty, and came to the conclusion that he had indigestion and sent him home with some remedies, and he died the next day. And it was one of those situations. Of course, the everybody was devastated, including the emergency physician. And when the physician and the psychiatrist talked over what happened, a startling admission from the emergency physician: there was evidence of a heart attack on the first electrocardiogram. And she said, "I looked at that ECG, but I couldn't see it." Now, she was honest. And one has to be grateful for her honesty. But my point is that there are days when you can look and not see. And that's probably what happened in this case. And it's very interesting. I guess another part of this that I think is worth mentioning is that there's supposed to be a 3-step procedure that's to prevent you from operating on the wrong side. You do a pre-procedure verification of where you're operating, who's the patient, etc. You mark the surgical site, and then you take a timeout just before surgery. And in fact, what researchers have discovered is that 72% of wrong side mistakes occur because he didn't take a timeout. And what is that? That is a very interesting phenomenon. So that's called taking a shortcut around the checklist, and that's called the normalization of deviance. And again, this is something that we tend to do in healthcare. I think other people do it in other areas of endeavor, where you take a shortcut. And you can take a shortcut for a bunch of reasons. The rules don't apply to me, or maybe you do it because your chief did it. And there's a whole bunch of reasons, but the psychologists tell us that if you deviate from the checklist 3 times and nothing bad happens, the new shortcut will become your new normal until something bad happens. And so that's something that we're just beginning to unpack. You know, I can give many, many examples here. I'm going to skip over that and just give you a case in point here. It's another example. A 21-year-old man admitted to hospital for investigation of severe chest pain, not a heart attack. He was given morphine, about 60 milligrams over 24 hours. He wasn't receiving decent pain relief. So the nurses called at about 5:30 in the afternoon, and he was switched to another drug called hydromorphone, same dose, 5 to 10 milligrams every 4 to 6 hours. And unfortunately, hydromorphone is 5 to 8 times more potent than morphine. He was found in bed after 3 shots with no vital signs and couldn't be resuscitated. And the point I'm trying to make here is the cognitive error, hearing hydromorphone, thinking morphine. You can do that in the moment. When you're under stress. That's the only point I'm trying to make here. This is a famous model of accident causation, root causes analysis, where you can analyze any kind of mishap, whether it's a nuclear disaster or an airplane disaster or a patient disaster, into a series of steps. And each step is a slice of Swiss cheese. And you know, my step may be step one. I order a medication to which the patient is allergic, and that's the first slice of Swiss cheese. The second slice might be a nurse saying, "Oh, Dr. Goldman, don't you remember? He's allergic to that." And so that's a Swiss cheese where there isn't a hole where the next Swiss cheese is. It's just a hunk of cheese. And conceptually, a disaster occurs when a series of steps occur, any one of which could have stopped the disaster, but the holes in the Swiss cheese line up. And that's the system-based notion of medical mistakes. And I love to ask polls of healthcare professionals, and most of us pay lip service to the system-based approach. Having said that, most of us still feel that personal sense of responsibility and that personal sense of shame that occurs with errors, and we rarely talk about our errors with our colleagues. And you know, we will disclose a single mistake, but I can guarantee you, if I ask a room full of health professionals, how would you feel about disclosing a second mistake 3 weeks later? The hands will go under your bum. You're not going to raise your hand so quickly because immediately that, you know, lazy or incompetent. Now you're pushing towards incompetence. And that is because the paradigm in medicine is that we're only permitted to make so many mistakes in our career. That's the paradigm. And that leads to this, lack of curiosity. And, you know, the Duke Colloquium is all about curiosity. Like, I'm curious about why I made that mistake. Oh, it's so hard if you feel that utter sense of shame when you make a mistake. And it's vicarious. We are not only ashamed of our own mistakes, we're ashamed of our colleagues' mistakes. And so we're not curious about their mistakes either. And when we have things like you know, M&M, morbidity and mortality rounds, it's almost like a see what you made us do. That's kind of the attitude that you get. Not in every, I'm not trying to slag every M&M. I'm sure that there are some that are really wonderful. Here's one guy who is curious. His name is Teodor Grantcharov. He is a general surgeon, a laparoscopic surgeon at St. Michael's Hospital in Toronto. He demonstrates his curiosity in 3 ways. First of all, he did something that almost nobody has done in the world. From the first day of his residency, he has been taking video of himself performing surgery. And I got to tell you something. You know, he was taking golf lessons, and he noticed that he could learn by improving, you know, improve his golf swing by looking, by taking a look at his own video, and why not do it in surgery? He had curiosity, and he has terabytes of his own operations on video, and he noticed his own mistakes, and he's corrected them ever since. He has done something else. He's done a study which he's presented at a meeting of surgeons. He hasn't had it published yet, in which he took eminent surgeons from around the world, had them shoot video of their operations, and had blinded observers observe the surgeons for mistakes. And the numbers were interesting. The surgeons, on average, made 15 mistakes per laparoscopic operation. Now, not all of those mistakes, in fact, none of them led to catastrophes. They could have, but the gravity of the errors we're not talking about right now. One of the errors that comes immediately to mind is that when you're looking at a laparoscope, what you're doing is you're looking at a monitor. You've got instruments that are outside the body. The handles are outside the body. The instruments are inside the belly, for instance. and you are manipulating them while looking at a screen. And there is a rule that says that you should never let one of those sharp instruments fall out of the field so that you can't see it. So anytime that happened, that was counted as a mistake, even if nothing bad happened as a direct result. The point I'm trying to make is that we are so incurious about mistakes that he had to go around the world and ask fellow experts, what is a mistake? Because there wasn't agreement on what is a mistake, and that's from lack of systemic curiosity about mistakes. The other thing that he's doing, and you know, what's the basketball? He used performance metrics that were pioneered in the NBA and other professional sports and is bringing them to the field of surgery. The other thing that he is doing is developing the world's first flight data cockpit recorder for the operating room. And that's why I would say that Teodor Grantcharov is as much a devil as that guy over there. I call him the most dangerous man in medicine because of that. I know we're coming close to the end. Another manifestation of our inability to confront mistakes and our shame about them is that anytime anybody points out our mistakes from outside, we get really defensive. Case in point, potassium chloride. It used to be that nurses would mix potassium into the intravenous. People had low potassium, they needed potassium. The problem with that is that every once in a while, somebody through a miscalculation would get too much potassium, which stops the heart, which is not good, and you would die. And so eventually, through enough lawsuits and enough dissemination of information, it became clear that it was necessary to take this mixing job out of the hands of nurses and put it in the pharmacy. And so pharmacists and risk management officers would go to the nurses and say, we got to do something about this, and they were very defensive. What? You're telling us we can't do it? And the pharmacist said, yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. What? You're telling us we're killing patients? Unfortunately, that's what I'm saying as well. So we are extremely defensive when we're confronted with that kind of information. I'm not going to talk about M&M because we can talk about it in the questions. I got 5 minutes and I want to talk about my mistake because so far I've been talking about other people's mistakes, but I want to talk about this one. This was not in the TED Talk. A real patient. So please take the information with respect. 33-year-old man, intoxicated with alcohol. He went balcony hopping, jumping from balcony to balcony, landed on his back, brought to the emergency department by paramedics at about 5 in the morning on a Saturday morning. He was complaining of back pain. He had no other life or limb-threatening injuries. I came on duty at 8 o'clock. Before I did that, a resident who was working the night shift with the attending saw the patient, found tenderness in the back, mainly down here in the lower thoracic region. No signs of a spinal cord injury or other injuries. Briefly discussed the patient with the night doctor. They ordered plain x-rays. I came on duty at 8 o'clock in the morning, and the night doctor suggested that the resident hand the patient over to me. So let me talk about it. I'm going to give you something that you don't get in medicine. I will give you the thought bubbles. I did the Saturday shift to help out a colleague. I had worked the Wednesday night and the Thursday night immediately prior, so I concluded my second night shift on Friday morning and had 24 hours to rest up prior to the 7 a.m. or 8 a.m. shift on the Saturday. I slept a few hours on Friday and slept again on that night, and I would describe myself honestly as alert but tired and cranky, and this was a more seriously ill patient, and I didn't feel as if I was easing into the shift, which we often did at that time. Second, anxiety. Handovers. This was sold to me as a package deal. Here's the assessment. Here's the plan. The assessment was frankly superficial. I'm not blaming that person. The plan, plain x-rays ordered in a hospital with 24/7 access to CT scans. Why wasn't a CT scan ordered? Isn't that standard of care? The other thing about this is it wasn't that the intern would be working with me. This was an intern who was working the night shift. It was handover and go home. Was I irritated that my predecessor didn't see the patient himself? Yes. So my assessment was one trivial fracture. I didn't ask the radiology resident to read the films. I repeated the CNS, the central nervous system neurological assessment. There were no deficits. I discharged the patient with a script for oxycocet, which is oxycodone and acetaminophen, kind of like Vicodin. He walked out of the emergency department. Here's the x-ray reporting system. The way it's supposed to work. All x-rays are to be read by a radiologist within 24 hours. That was at the time. That's changed. And put on a computer reporting system. Any significant discrepancies between my interpretation and the radiologist's interpretation are to be highlighted in red on this queue and phoned to the emergency physician on duty, whoever's working at the time. None of that happened. I arrived, I worked Sunday, no word on Sunday. I arrived for a shift that Monday morning at noon. On the way in, the departmental receptionist gave me a message saying the patient's mother had called, he was in pain. That prompted me to check the x-ray report. Still not transcribed, but a lengthy audio tape that I listened to in dawning horror. I missed fractures of 2 vertebrae in the neck, 4 in the, four in the thoracic spine. I missed a big one at T12. That was the big one. I thought it was an L1 fracture. It was a T12. Very different, because now you're risking getting some nerves that could result in paraplegia. The report, if you want the system, was on the queue but not highlighted in red. There was no phone call to the emergency physician on duty. And really, if I wasn't on duty, if I didn't have a particular interest in this patient, how long would it have taken for somebody else to know and discover the mistake? I phoned the mother and instructed her to return the patient, to call 911 and have EMS, emergency medical system, bring him in with full spine precautions. And he arrived in a lot of pain. Fortunately, he was neurologically intact. And I arranged for transfer to a neurosurgeon, and I must have repeated his neurological exam 10 times before I sent him without change. One more thing. Before he left the department, I sat down with he and his mother and his girlfriend, and I apologized and itemized each and every mistake that I made. All of the errors, why, what I would do personally to keep them from happening again. I apologized and I answered all of their tough questions, but the one that will stick with me forever is what could have happened from the time you discharged him until the time he was brought back. And I answered it honestly. Postscript. 5 days following the surgery, he underwent a successful surgery. He was discharged from hospital. He has done relatively well. Admittedly, he has had a rocky course because he has chronic pain as a direct result of his injuries, and there have been some concerns over opioid dependency. So what did I learn? What I learned from that is no more unhealthy shift trades. And I have learned, I was irritated with colleagues who appeared to be skipping out. And now I have completely turned that around. I actually walk into the hospital saying, I love handover patients. I love handover patients. I adore handover patients. And in fact, I have worked really, really hard to turn that negative into a positive. And that was the one that I really had to learn. And I've learned it since then. And I want every physician who works with me who's going home to be able to say, I got your back. And I do. Other things, I didn't call the radiologist consultant to read the films, and I've learned how to swallow my pride and do that. And you know, including the times when I've, you know, a radiologist has snapped back saying, well, Dr. Goldman, if you can't read that film, you shouldn't be a physician. And that's just attitude. That's not a wise thing to do. What we need, and I'm going to open it up to questions just now, is for health professionals and the public to acknowledge that with humans, mistakes are inevitable, and that we have to accept that humans make mistakes. We have to look for ways to prevent mistakes. We have to adopt technology to support us, to mitigate, or to increase the likelihood that the mistakes will be discovered sooner. If we are asking for people like me to be more productive, then we have to think about taking some of our duties away, the ones that are not particularly germane to what we do, if we want to make the system safer. And we have to foster and support among healthcare workers an opportunity to discuss in a loving, respectful way mistakes, not have a smart person at the front of the room tell you what you did wrong, but instead ask everybody involved, what do you think happened? Why was the decision that you made, why did it seem to you to be the right decision at that moment? But most important, be curious. Be curious. And we have to teach health professionals to be curious about the mistakes they make, but the first thing you have to do before you can be curious is to admit them. Thank you.
If you would please pass your questions to the end of the rows, our student directors, Noni and Jocelyn, will come by and collect them. So our first question was one of the pre-submitted questions before the event, and it comes from Dr. Laura Nyedi from Ophthalmology. Her question is, increasingly, patients and their families want their care faster and cheaper with no mistakes. So how do we go about transforming patient expectations of doctors?
Well, the only way that, you know, everybody wants things faster and cheaper, and you know, I think that we have to be honest with our patients, we have to be honest with families and say that something that is faster may not be safer, and we all have limits. I think that there, you know, we certainly run the risk of acceding to the demand for speed and at the expense of, and that's the productivity pressure that I was talking about, at the expense of safety. And sometimes we have to be straight with our patients and say, I can't do that as fast as you want it to be. Unless, of course, you're talking about a situation where there's an inordinate or an unwarranted delay that could result in harm to the patient. And sometimes, you know, I think we have to spend time dealing with the expectations of our patients, and you know, if somebody says they can do it twice as fast and just as safe, then I think a constructive response to that would be, okay, we're going to take a look at what they're doing there, and we'll see, and be humble, because maybe they're right. Maybe somebody else has found a way to deliver care that's faster, that's just as safe, but more often than not, they don't.
Thank you. Our next question actually comes from an undergraduate, Gregory Moore, Trinity, class of 2015. In your TED Talk, you mentioned mistakes that had very visible consequences. So what obligation does a physician have to admit mistakes that might not have such an extreme visible impact?
Right. That's a really good question. And if you follow the Joint Commission on Accreditation of Hospitals and other healthcare organizations, the precept is clear. You have to admit that you've made a mistake. And as soon as possible after, not wait 3 weeks to do it at a time that might be more comfortable for you or for other members of the healthcare team. And you know, it's interesting because there are studies that show that in spite of the fact that we all know, those of us who do procedures that have risk, that we have an obligation to inform people of the benefits, the anticipated risks, what the alternatives are to saying no to the procedure, trying something else instead. We all uniformly agree that we're supposed to do that. And yet, a survey published last year, February 2012, found that 30% of respondents, physicians, actually argued that they didn't feel comfortable talking about an error that led to serious harm. And in fact, 20% argued with the notion that they were supposed to be honest with their patients. I think we're well beyond that. The ethical precept today is that the physician and other members of the healthcare team have a duty to disclose, and they should do so as soon as possible afterwards. And, you know, we had an interesting discussion about this at dinner, and you know, the importance of, it's not just because it's a rule, it's important to do it because of the possibility of undermining trust. If you undermine trust, you know, okay, so no harm came, it was fairly trivial, you know, what will happen later on if the patient finds out, if the family finds out there was an error and you didn't talk about it? That will undermine trust. Whereas if you disclose and apologize, there are some tangible benefits. It strengthens the doctor-patient relationship. It actually aids in patient recovery, and it results in fewer lawsuits and lower damages. So, you know, it's right. It's the right thing to do, and it's the smart thing to do.
Thank you. One more question before we move on to some of our questions from the audience that were submitted during the event. And this comes from a student in the School of Medicine. How did these mistakes that you've made and the reflections you've had change the way you practice medicine? I think you discussed that a little bit.
Yes. So first, the first one that I talked about in my TED Talk, it didn't. And that was the problem. And I kind of didn't articulate it, but I think you sort of got the idea that I was still living in that world where I thought that I was supposed to be perfect, and that, you know, that kind of that fantasy world where you think that if enough time passes, it will wash over you, you do your penance. And in fact, you know, that's a very common belief. That's one of the things that's wrong with morbidity and mortality rounds, that very often it's in service not of the patient but of apologizing to colleagues for in the words of John Banja, who's a bioethicist from Emory University, apologizing to fellow physicians for shattering the illusion of physician perfection. And which I think is a very, very interesting thing. It's not an apology to patients. That's not the purpose of mortality and morbidity. So that was in the past. More recently, when I began to like myself and accept myself, to realize that mistakes were part and parcel of a complex system and that they would exist for the rest of my life, part of it is that I have a mindset to notice my own mistakes. Other people are much better at rationalizing their own mistakes away. And that's part of the problem. We're not curious enough about what could have gone wrong. Since I came to a greater self-acceptance, what I usually strive to do is meditate about my mistakes. I reach out to the family. I apologize. I find that a heartfelt apology helps me. I talk to my colleagues, which is a very, very important thing to do. And I've sought out colleagues who are not silent, who will. I mean, one of my criteria is that you know, certainly what we know about counseling people who've made errors is that what they want is someone to talk to. They want someone to validate that they're still competent. They want somebody to validate that their thinking processes weren't totally out to lunch at the moment that it happened. And we often don't do that. In that kind of an environment, what I'm looking for is to listen to that still small voice, not the, you know, beyond the rationalizations. And it was in that moment in the radiological, in the balcony hopper, that I realized that I was too ticked off with the night doctor for handing over a complicated patient. And now my spidey senses are on the lookout for potentially unstable patients who are being handed over in the morning. And I will do things like ask more questions if my sense is that they're unstable or that they could have a life-threatening problem that we're not sure what it is. I'm looking for things like a plan. Is the plan of investigation to find out, to diagnose the problem, is it one plan, like it's all or nothing, and you're going to hear about one of these tomorrow night that I'm going to talk about, or is there a wider differential diagnosis, which is what it's supposed to be? Like, if it isn't, you know, you're ordering a CT scan. If it isn't if the CT scan's normal, what else could it be? So those are the things that I'm trying to do. I'm usually trying to find the thinking mistakes that I've made, and that was the big one in that case. The other one is to avoid, like the plague, calling the radiologists. And now, you know, I ask for help much, much more often. Those are the two big things that I learned from that one. But I'm always going through the process with each time, each mistake, to say, what else could I have done that's different in this case? And more important, why did I think it was the right thing to do at that moment?
Thank you. I think Noni has a couple questions from the audience.
So our first question that we're going to ask is from Hong Zhu, undergrad in 2014. And this person says that you mentioned that the medical profession would benefit from being more accepting of mistakes, but do you think it's possible for us to become too accepting of mistakes? In other words, will human nature always lead us to be excessively intolerant of mistakes, or is there instead a golden mean level of ideal tolerance for failure?
A nice philosophical question that we should talk about at length over a beer. You know, I get this question all, and it's a great question. I get this question all the time. You know, it speaks to the issue of, you know, if you're accepting of mistakes, well, doesn't that mean that you're less, you know, doesn't that mean are you striving to make mistakes? No, I'm not striving to make mistakes. That's not what this is about. We're talking about good people in the line of fire under stress, making decisions that are often thinking mistakes. And if we asked each one of them to leave the profession, we'd be asking everybody to leave, because everybody's making mistakes all the time, and the opportunities to make mistakes are presenting themselves with greater and greater frequency. So given all of that, all I'm asking for is for us as individual practitioners to become more curious about our mistakes, and the system should be more curious about mistakes. Now, does that mean I'm condoning them? No. And I would be quick to point out that if we're talking about a pattern of repeated mistakes, then at some point it has to get to authorities. And so that person has to be not just investigated or punished. That's the wrong model. Often it's talking to them, and maybe it's the state board talking to them, or it's the hospital talking to them, or it's colleagues, depending on the situation. And maybe they need to take a time out, maybe they need to take retraining, maybe they need to move into a different line of work within the health professions, or leave it entirely. But the notion notion that we can deal with errors by punishing people doesn't work. It simply encourages people to be silent and embarrassed and ashamed. And by not talking about mistakes, you never discover them. If you don't discover them in your own mistakes, you can't do anything about them. You can't learn about them. So I don't celebrate mistakes, but I do make a promise that I'm going to learn one thing that I can pass on. And I can tell you that I have saved many people based on the mistakes that I've made. You know, that because of the mistakes that I've made, I've become a better physician as a result.
So you mentioned in your talk that your experiences in medical school did not really prepare you for the reality of mistake-making in your profession. So one student in the audience asked, what should professors teach students about making medical mistakes?
Well, I'd like to think that it's changing. And I think that, for instance, a good example, and I had a blank. I had a senior moment when I blanked on his name, and I'd be very sorry if I didn't say, Pat Crosscarry is his name. Patrick Crosscarry was a psychologist in Britain before he came to Canada to live out his dream of going to medical school at McMaster University in Hamilton, Ontario, and became an emergency physician, and then went back to his psychology roots and developed cognitive psychology as it applies to medical errors, and in particular in the emergency department. So I can tell you that in undergraduate, they're starting to teach cognitive psychology as it applies. And that's the in thing right now. And, you know, we're talking about risk at root causes analysis but particularly I think cognitive psychology has a lot to teach us about the kinds of mistakes that we make. Is it enough? It's not. And it's going to take a long, long time for the culture of medicine to change. And you know, somebody who I respect very much a few months ago said to me, you know, the problem with heroes, you know, there are heroes in hospitals, champions of patient safety, champions of being forgiving about mistakes and teaching people how to deal with them in a constructive way. The problem with that is that as soon as the champion or the hero retires, they're gone. And it's like gravity, you know, inertia. We tend to get pulled back towards that shame, that silence. And I hope that you know, we're starting to see more and more experts from the airline industry, for instance, aviation safety, talking to us, that we can adopt some of their techniques. Some of them won't work, but others will work very well. I can give this talk. You can go to an undergraduate class tomorrow and not hear a thing about errors, and again be left with the wheels spinning in your brain because all you're hearing is silence.
So we have time for one final question, and feel free to ask more at the Digging Deeper lunch on Thursday if you'll be there. So we have a student who wanted to ask about what you think an ideal way for an institutional to approach discussing mistakes would look like. If morbidity and mortality conferences aren't particularly effective and you could redesign them, how would you do that?
Okay, that's a great question. It's a good way to end. There's a couple of media that can be used through which to discuss these. I don't want to say that we have all the answers right now. We don't. But it generally, what seems to work is an opportunity, first of all, to debrief. And in the same way that after the most mundane flight, the airline industry, the cockpit crew will debrief. This is the course heading that we had. This is where we were going. This was the speed, and these were the issues that we had on during the flight, and then we landed. Air traffic controllers have the same kind of debrief. The military has debriefs after high risk missions. So debriefing is beginning to make its way into healthcare, particularly in critical care areas like the pediatric intensive care unit, the surgical intensive care unit, the cardiovascular intensive care unit, et cetera. And these are regular daily occurrences. They're huddles. They can be formal or informal, but they give everybody a voice and an opportunity to participate. There's no, I'm the boss and you're not, you don't speak because you don't have a right to speak. Everybody has a right to speak in the same way that, you know, those famous commercials, was it the Toyota or, you know, one of the car commercials where they had the assembly line worker who said, I pushed the button and stopped the assembly line because I found a flaw, I found a mistake. And you welcome everybody's participation. So that's one thing. When a near miss occurs, Like, you want this to be so mundane that everybody's comfortable reporting all the time. And you know, I want to have, I want to work in a world where somebody can say, Goldman, you were tired last night, but not with that edgy tone that says, you were tired last night and you better show up next time with a good, you know, having rested well. Otherwise, we're going to be thinking about replacing you. But, and that, and, you know, and they won't say it, but they'll, but the silence will say that. What I would like to see is a system where somebody puts a hand on my shoulder and says, Goldman, you look like you're under a bit of stress. And I go, yeah, I am. I had this situation in my home last night. And instead of saying, you look tired, silence, they respond with, how can I help you today? Not, how can I help you get some counseling, but how can I help you in the next 12 hours on the shift? That says it's okay. That validates that it's okay to do that. So those are the kinds of things that I'd recommend, and I would recommend a third thing that I'm seeing, particularly among residents. I'm starting to see residents in hospital that are getting together for reflective rounds. And these are opportunities for them to talk about difficult issues and do so with a mentor or mentors, but it's all done very respectfully, it's all confidential, and it gives them an opportunity to realize that they're not alone. So those are two or three kinds of approaches that I would recommend. The debrief, the reflection, and that personal, I'm here to help.
Wow, what a wonderful question to end on. Well, I think that's all the time we have tonight, so thank you all for coming.
Produced by Duke University. Online at duke.edu.